So, good evening, everyone. Thanks for having me here. My name is Sonja Bäumel. So, as Rüdiger already said, and as you can hear from my English pronunciation, I grew up in Vienna, but since several years, my studio is based in Amsterdam, and I'm working somewhere in between these two cities. And my works across various disciplines, some of them are my background, like design and fashion. And I kind of combine design, art, fashion, and biological practice. And I would like to start the presentation with a short film, which is unfortunately not the best resolution, but I really wanted to show it because it was a crucial moment for me. First of all, because I saw the first time microorganisms, these small creatures kind of floating under my eye. But also it was in the year 2008 when I started to practical work with bacteria. I had several interviews at different universities in the Netherlands, and actually the Wageningen University was the one which opened me the doors in order to get to know the material I wanted to deal with, to see how bacteria grow and how they behave. And I will try my best to kind of compromise these 7 years in the short time given. And I decided today to actually, I will talk about work samples, about process. For me, process is very important. It has the same value like the outcome. And I decided to actually speak more in fields of interest and more in the project context. So let's start. So the first topic is the perception of the human body. I would like to start with the Dutch man, the one which actually described as the first man microorganism, Anthony van Leeuwenhoek. And he first was disaffected to publicize his findings because he regarded himself as a man with too less knowledge about science. But his curiosity and his passion for lens making actually enabled him to let people see the world with new eyes. And I think that's perfectly described by the words of Johann Wolfgang Goethe, which described the artist alone, his spirits, but after he has told of their appearing to him, everybody sees them. So actually, since the discovery of Anthony van Leeuwenhoek, the research in bacteria is not a linear success story, but I will really make a big jump in recent research. And I would like to start with the Human Genome Project, which was in the year 2000, when the first human genome sequence actually showed us that we human beings are not individuals, but that we are actually a hybrid and a symbiotic ecosystem, which actually can sustain because different life forms on the body collaborate with each other. And then 8 years later, the US National Institute of Health launched a project called the Human Microbiome Project. And that, or they still work on that, so they started at the time to characterize, but also to identify all microorganisms living in and on us. And this was a very crucial paradigm shift in the practice of research, because for hundreds of years, actually, bacteria were studied isolated, so not with their social behavior or behavior within them. It emerged out a new field, which is called metagenomics. And metagenomics actually looks really, they can take samples from the environment, and so to say, really, they can study bacteria in their behavior, in their context, so how they interact with each other. So all this scientific research revealed actually a quite crazy thing. Humans have 10 times more bacterial cells than human cells. An adult carries around 3 to 4 bacteria, 4 kilos of bacteria in and on us. And we have 100 trillions of bacteria living in and on us. So in my projects, I'm really interested to kind of to look from this perspective or to stimulate cultural imagination in regards to this paradigm shift in microbiology. So when we think about this high number of bacteria, most of the bacteria actually live in the intestine. So you could actually pose the question, who feeds here whom? And as a further question, if 90% of cells that constitute our body are not human but bacterial, how do we have to reimagine the human, and where could this new knowledge lead to? And here I wanted to start with a project which I actually realized, especially for an exhibition this summer at the Vaag Society. It's an institute for art, science and technology based in Amsterdam. And the exhibition was in the anatomical theater. And as you can see, the process in my work challenged me very often in very unexpected ways. So basically, I start a question, I go into the process, and then I find myself in situations which I never thought ever before I will be in. For instance, I was lying 5 hours, only with 2 holes open of my nose, in a silicone and plaster mold in order to prepare this work. So for me, it's really not important to create these perfected objects. But for me, it's actually more important to reflect upon ways to document my ongoing thoughts and also to express my intentions or give answers to my questions. And so basically, I use the exhibition space as a lab. So here is the anatomical theater, and what you see here, usually scientists use these 7 centimeter petri dishes, so it's a very huge petri dish. And inside you see three-dimensional body parts, and all the material you see inside is actually agar. So agar is the food or the nutrients bacteria need in order to grow visible. And the layer you see on the top, which you can see better here, yellow and whitish in that case, is a layer of bacteria. So it's a kind of also wanting to say that it's casted in one piece, but actually the body is made out of a lot of different parts which accumulate and get into a shape. But also it wants, or I want to initiate a process and place it in an exhibition space, and of course, consequently, I don't know exactly what's going to happen. Of course, it's a kind of controlled experiment, but still, you don't know. It will evolve over the exhibition, and in that case, there were a lot of surprises. And so, somehow, reflect on that actually, art is here an area of cultural experimentation, and me as an artist, I become a researcher. So here I also want to create a space of how we actually could reimagine bacteria's collaboration partners and what we actually could learn from them. So we know that basically bacteria are since billions of years on planet Earth, and I would say they really successfully adapted to different environmental circumstances, like to highly temperature, to acid circumstances. So I think it's interesting to look at them from a different perspective and not define them actually as something negative or something you need to fight, so to say, the invisible. Of course, we all know that they can cause diseases, but it's interesting that most of the bacteria which are actually existing in nature are harmless, so why not try to to find ways of, I would say, respecting each other. So I don't know, the human being has often that that kind of thoughts that everything which is smaller than its own scale has less value. So to kind of accept them as equal partners, so to say. And I would also say that this is one of my deepest objectives, to kind of find symbiotic relationships between different living forms. And here I also want to show you a work from Christina Agabakis, sorry, she's a microbiologist, and Cecil Tolas, she's an artist working with smell. And the project was called Self-Made, and it was part of the Synthetic Aesthetics, which was a very nice initiative from the Edinburgh University and Stanford University, where they actually brought together synthetic biologists, artists, designers, and social scientists. And the two of them were actually working to, they made cheese. They made cheese, and the starting culture was the human body. So they took samples from the nose and the feet. And I think it's a very interesting project because here the object itself is a scientific object, but at the same time it's also an artistic object. And it's kind of questioning or reflecting on our acceptance of bacteria on us, but also on on our biotechnology in the broader sense. Then my main focus in the research, or my main interest, is human skin. So I would call it visible skin, but especially the invisible skin. So I'm since 7 years really driven in understanding kind of the platform which surrounds the human body, but also the environment, and how actually this interaction is happening, and also how we could use this interaction to find new forms of interaction between humans and their environment. So here you can see this semi-transparent textile. It's actually a hand crocheted and hand knitted piece. And the bacteria which you see in color, so the textile interpretation of bacteria, are focused here on 20 body parts. And the scientific information comes from skin bacteria, which I studied for 8 months together with a scientist. So we looked actually where we found what. And this scientific information I interpreted in this textile piece. Also to make scientific knowledge tangible and accessible actually for a really broader audience. So when you look here on the right side, you see a painting from the Renaissance where we actually really looked inside the body. So very for decades, the human skin was actually not, I think, underestimated, or the focus was just somewhere else. It was more seen as a kind of packaging, so to say, for the body. And not later as a membrane, but it was really the skin is the border of the human body. So we humans are discrete membrane-bound organisms. But I would argue, and that's for me until now the best description I found, it's actually from Reg Morrison, speaking about the work from a biologist, and he defines us human beings as semi-continuous spectrum of interactive bacterial nations. So this work was called Expand Itself, and there I use this work again to blur this this skin border, which is traditionally seen as something which is a border. And it was especially made for a film which was called Wir sind Planeten from Terra Mater Servus TV. So they were actually filming what lives in on the body, especially on the skin. And especially for this project, I realized this this Expand Itself project. And at that time, it was the biggest petri dish I ever used. And we used the petri dish basically as a canvas and some liters of agar. And the bacteria on my body's color. But it's not just a print what lives now. It actually had a lot of preparation. So the preparation is, or the performance is in a sterile room. And I actually remove my existing human skin flora and I apply a million times higher the skin flora I studied for over 8 months. And then I lie on this agar, which after some days, then this amazing landscape arises, so to say. And also this project challenged me in a lot of ways. First of all, because it's living material. So it's really a new material which we have to treat, of course, in a different way. You need to care a lot of it, which is beautiful, but it's also very surprising. It has this surprising effect because you can make a lot of experiments, but then still it lives and it's creatures, and you actually sometimes don't know exactly how it will, how they will grow. So I had sleepless nights. If the silhouette of the human body actually will be grown when the film team comes, and but luckily they came. But it also challenged me in different other ways because I needed to get naked in front of a film team and light in January 2012 in this agar plate, in this cold chalet. And I had to laugh so much because the situation was quite absurd. So as you see at the head here, all these cracks happened. But perhaps you could see this, or maybe you could see this as a failure, so to say, because of the cracks. But I think actually these parts of the work, these are the ones which makes it exciting because it's really alive and it shows reality. So again, what I mentioned before, I don't want to show these perfected objects, which is actually quite unreal, so to say. And also, I was reflecting these days a lot about failure, or what is failure, and I wanted to share with you a text which I found very nice from Kevin Kelly, which actually writes about failure in a positive way, so to say, so we have to redefine it. And he says, failure is not something to be avoided, but something to be cultivated. What is science? And here I have to say, I think you could also replace science with other fields. What is science, after all, but a way to learn from things that don't work, rather than just those that do? You should aim for success while being prepared to learn from a series of failures. More so, you should carefully but deliberately press your successful investigations or accomplishments to the point where they break, flop, crash, or fail. And with this work, or this work is a kind of metaphor of seeing ourselves or of new points of view of actually who we are or what we are. And the next field of interest, and that's actually one of my backgrounds, as I said at the beginning, is fashion. And I think that was actually the starting point from where everything kind of grew out. And I would like to replace the word fashion with the definition of the biggest nonverbal interaction platform between humans, because it gives myself much more freedom for experimentation, but also the possibility to activate this platform in a critical, or use it as a critical platform to reflect on developments in science or in biotechnology. And this was, when I wrote my thesis, which was called Invisible Visible Membrane, Life on the Human Body and its Design Application, I actually spent this 1 year to kind of, or it started actually by reflecting and questioning fashion. So could we actually build up a biological new system on our body, which could change the interaction between us and the environment? That was one of the starting points. Or do we expect too little from our biggest nonverbal platform between humans? And I started with, or that was the first project, which I called Crocheted Membrane, and it's in total 7 hand crocheted pieces, I would say body parts, and it has a kind of fictional aesthetic because, yeah, not because, I will come to that later. So I took with a heating camera pictures of my body with 10 degrees outside temperature, and I applied this knowledge, so to say, on the body, because I was thinking, what actually if we would have a communication layer where bacteria which are existing on our skin could communicate, okay, here it's warm, please build the material up, and here it's cold, please open up. And it's very interesting when you play this thought over the whole body, because it shows really a fundamental change in the aesthetic and function of clothes. So it's not anymore the starting point, which is really based in historical patterns about material richness, but it's based on the individual need, in that case, physical needs of an outside temperature. But could we kind of base this material on physical needs and individual beliefs and social needs? So I ask questions, for instance, would social integration take faster place via the adaptation to the environment and the surrounding? And what would that mean? So here I create this kind of fictional aesthetic also to explore, to reflect, to imagine, but also to use to kind of open up the limitations the fashion role has, so to say. So my last field of interest, which I want to speak about today, is human-bacteria chemical communication and collective behavior. So this is a project which is called MetaBodies, and I did that in collaboration with Manuel Selk, which is, I'm very happy he's also here today. And we worked 4 weeks. I had an artist in residence at the Ars Electronica Center in the Future and BioLab, and in this project, we tested 2 persons. They always left a left handprint on an agar plate. So you can see here in the top row, in that line, that this is the handprint of a woman and this is the handprint of a man. And the first row shows basically the handprint after running, the second one is after having a shower, and the third one is after having sex, and then he needed to call me, and then I started this time lapse. And I wanted on one part basically to see what these images reveal, in a sense of, could this be a new tool in order to understand bacteria in a specific context, but mainly this project focused on bacterial communication. So in a scientific language, you call that bacteria quorum sensing. And it's when bacteria grow to a sufficient number, they can actually collectively behave and make, in that case, light. So we created an organism which glows when there is communication going on this handprint. And it was very much to see how the communication actually, or the aim was, we intended to see where the communication actually takes place in a different context. And this is absolutely an ongoing project. So this is a process step again of the of that work. Yeah, and next to that, I teach in Amsterdam in an art academy, and I do internationally bio workshops in different cities and countries. For me, this is very important in order to kind of involve and engage a bigger audience in this research field, and to democratize, so to say, scientific research, and to start discussions related to new developments in biotechnology. So here is, for instance, a workshop I did this year at Mediamatic, which is a cultural institution in Amsterdam. And here we are in the sterile hood. But I think also, yeah, this was another workshop which we called Biologic, where we actually combined digital computing and the biologic world, so to say. We were hacking a 3D printer and wanted instead to print with plastic or other things. We experimented and succeeded one day before the workshop with printing actually agar, and it was about swarm behavior. But this would now extend my presentation time to go in detail. So I just want to give you very fast a hint. So I'm super excited because I started actually this month with a new project, which is called 10% Human. And it's going to be more interdisciplinary, so there will be both the cultural historian, a scientist, and another artist. And during the time, collaborations will flow in, so to say. And I will use the first time metagenomic methodology. And I want to create objects which you actually can wear and you experience. So, yeah, I'm looking forward now to your reflections and thoughts and questions, and thank you for your attention.